will enter hell on the same day, the day of judgment, which use, which they used to deny. And they of Fajar will not be absent therefrom. That is, they will abide in hell. And what will make you know what the day of recompense is? Again, what will make you know what the day of recompense is? The purpose of the petition is to drive home the importance of the day. It will be the day when no person shall have power to do anything for another, and the division that day will be wholly with Allah.
Okay.
Here.
Good. That's it, right? Okay, Bismillah. So once again, Bismillah, as we're streaming now. So we're doing Surat Al-Infitar, Surat number 82. It was revealed in the Meccan period, right? It's a Mecki Surah, and it has 19 ayats, 19 verses. So let us begin with the first three verses, Brother Amshad.
السماء انفطرت وإذا الكواكب انتثرت وإذا
البحار
وإذا البحار فجرت.
Good. فجرت.
فجرت.
Good. So now read from the beginning, like Surah Al-Fitr 82, from the Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In English. No, I read the English.
Oh.
Yeah, so now we're doing the tafsir. So read the English, inshallah.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious, most merciful. When the heavens shall be cleft asunder, when the heavens are cleft asunder by Allah's command, and the angels start descending to earth, and when the stars shall be fallen and scattered,
mm-hmm.
And when the seas shall be burst forth, the waters of all the seas will collect in a single sea. When Allah will send a westerly wind which will ignite a fire in the water, the flames of which will rise sky high.
So two things will happen, right? So it said, وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ فُجِّرَتْ. Two things. So here the oceans, right? The bodies of water, right? So in Surah Ar-Rahman, مَرَجَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ يَلْتَقِيَانِ بَيْنَهُمَا بَرْزَخُ لَا يَبْغِيَانِ. Right? The two bodies of water meet. Between them, the salt water and the sweet water, they meet. But between them, there is a barrier that they cannot supersede each other, right? They stay within the limits that Allah set, right? But when this happens, that means that those barriers will be destroyed, right? So that's what it means. So وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ فُجِّرَتْ, and it's in the tafsir, the waters of all the seas will become one. So this is plural. Al Bihar plural.
Yeah,
Bahru is singular.
Bahrain is two.
Bahrain or Bahrain. Bahrain is two. Bahrain is two. Right. So depending on where the word is in the sentence. Right, so Bahar is singular, Bihar, that word Bihar is plural, three or more. So he is saying that all of the bodies of water, وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ, right, all of the bodies of water will mix and it will become one, right? So that system will be destroyed. So this is what's telling us. All of the systems start falling apart, right? This is before the Day of Judgment. Right, so now, and then what? A fire will be ignited in the water. That's also going against the nature. Why? Because water is supposed to turn off fire. Right? So the water will be ignited in the ocean.
That means the water will split into hydrogen and oxygen, and then the fire will...
Allahu alam, right? All we know, I mean, that's, you know, that all these systems that we know of, if you dig deep into, see, like, for example, alhamdulillah, we have, you know, beautiful presentations that exist about, for example, miracles of the Quran through science, right? Like, we have a presentation this coming Friday, alhamdulillah. It's great to reflect and see, you know, what science has discovered and so on. Alhamdulillah. I was asked a question by a reporter one time. And the question was phrased like this. Can science verify the Quran? Right? And I said, no. Actually, science is verified by the Quran. Right? Whatever the science is discovered is because Allah, the Creator, placed it there. Right? So Allah is the everlasting, and His words are the Quran. So whatever is it, like Alaqa, right? It was known, they believed in it. It was discovered in the 18th century. And it was mentioned in the second ayat of the Quran, right? So, did they disbelieve in it because they didn't understand it? They didn't have the tools to investigate that matter, but they believed in it because it came from Allah. That's the level of iman that they had. Nowadays, you say, "Oh, it doesn't make sense scientifically." That's the level of iman that we have reached. With so much technology, we have reached that level. Right, that's so, subhanAllah, alhamdulillah, it's good to you know, for worship, to look at the disciplines, the different sciences. And if you go into, for example, and that's why if a person focuses on only one science, then you will not get the full benefit of the Quran. For example, let's say you wanna say, I wanna look at the Quran from the legal aspect. Law in the Quran, that can also take a person on a different journey, right? In Harvard University, they were investigating the ayahs from different scriptures, and they discovered from all the scriptures, they wanted to pick the verses, so they did research. They wanted to select from these scriptures the verses that signify the highest level of justice. And they pick number one, the verse from the Quran, right? Right. All you who believe, قُومُ قَوَّمِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ. Be upright in justice, right? Witnesses for Allah, even if it is against yourself, or even if it is against your parents, right, or your relatives. Or even if the person that you have to be just towards, even if he is rich, you know, sometimes we play with the decisions because the person is a position, right? And it happens with organizations as well. Because this person is a major donor, I'm not going to mess with him. I want to secure that donor, right? Is he the Razik or is Allah? We have to, this is part of Iman, right? This is part of Iman. Based on principles emanating from the Quran, we make decisions, right? So Allah tells us, if he is rich or poor, even if he's poor, oh, khalas, he made a mistake, he's poor. Allah knows that, right, that we might be inclined because of these things. And then Allah says, what? فَاللَّهُ أَوْلَى بِهِمَا. Allah should be the first priority. Allah should be the first priority. And if you fail to be just, then know that Allah is well aware of your decisions. So that verse was chosen in the Harvard University School of Law, and it was placed in the entrance of the Faculty of Law. in a big poster, an ayah from the Quran. After doing, after these educated individuals did their research and found that they got that from the Quran, they used that. You could take the ayah and explain in volumes, right? So some will take the Quran in science, some will take in law, some will take linguistically, and they will just, you know, be doing, you know, linguistic acrobats and different types of, right, you know, you find so many things, right? Just looking at, just studying the words of the Quran. One word is like sun rays. So many different meanings. So the Quran itself is like an ocean, right? Or like Allah says, an ocean, Allah says singular, right? In Surah Al-Kahf. In another surah, Allah says what? If you want to write the words of Allah, if you bring Saba'a Abhur, see, also Abhur is also plural, right? Seven seas. So you have Bihar and Abhur. Keep that in mind. That wasn't even, see, you wanted to learn that word? That is another plural. And sometimes there's two types of plural in Arabic. So here Allah says, if you want to write the words of Allah, then even if you bring seven bodies of water, you will not be able to write it. They'll be exhausted. Right? So this is the Quran. And Ibn Taymiyyah, Shaykh al-Islam, he was called the Shaykh al-Islam because he mastered all of the disciplines. He mastered Arabic, he mastered fiqh, he mastered all these disciplines to such an extent that he wrote Majmu' al-Fatawa, right? And yes, he had his circumstances. He was in prison most of the time. He suffered a lot. He went through wars and all that. So you might feel that when things are translated from his works into English, sometimes it seems a little bit harsh and people will judge that. But when we look at a scholar, at any scholar, we look at this scholar and let's look at his circumstances, the time that he lived, right? What did he experience? He was driven out from his hometown, went to Syria because of the Tatars, etc., etc. So we have to look at these things, right? Before falling into judgments of any scholar. So Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, after writing a book on the sciences of Quran, he says, finally, and he's a sheikh, known as Sheikh al-Islam, he said, scholars will not be able to penetrate the depths of the Quran. Right? After you reach a level of that knowledge, then you say, and he's known as Sheikh al-Islam during his time. He still says, out of humbleness, out of truthfulness, he said, the scholars, nowadays you have people who maybe study one book of tafsir, or maybe partial book of tafsir, and they will say, I understand the verse. I understand this juz, you know, khalas, I already read it, you know, and so on. Once you say that, then you're wronging yourself, you're limiting yourself. Leave it open because Allah's knowledge is infinite. So that means that you should continue seeking until when? Until you go to the grave. That's the time. So let us go to the 4, 5, and 6, inshallah. Fadl, brother Ayub.
وَإِذَا الْقُبُورُ بُعْثِرَتْ عَلِمَتْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ وَأَخَّرَتْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْإِنسَانُ مَا غَرَّكَ بِرَبِّكَ الْكَرِيمِ And translation. And when the grave shall be turned upside down and bring out their contents, that is, the dead will rise from their graves, bu'thirat, overturned, or the earth covering them will be turned over. Then a person will know what he has sent forward and what he has left behind, or good or bad deeds. That is, when the aforementioned events have taken place, everyone will see the sequel of his actions. The actions he left behind means the example he left behind for others. Whatever a man does, it influences others in one way or another. If a man does good actions, he will also be rewarded. If others follow his example, conversely, if one behaves wickedly, he will partake of the sins of all those who follow his wicked example. O man, what has made you careless about your Lord the most generous. That is, what beguiles you, O man, concerning your bountiful Lord who created you, gave you intelligence and senses, and provided you with the means of sustenance.
Okay. So here in the ayah, right? This is an important ayah. I just want to partner this ayah with an ayah that we already did the tafsir of, right? The ayah in Surah Yasin. Alimat nafsum ma qaddamat wa akharat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the bottom part of the page of Surah Yasin, إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ نُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى وَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَدَّمُوا وَآثَارَهُمْ وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ أَحْصَيْنَاهُ فِي إِمَامٍ مُبِينٍ. Right, so here Allah says what? Like we prescribe, right? We give life and we give death. And we write whatever you did in this dunya. وَآثَارَهُمْ. آثَارَهُمْ means what? Right? آثَارَهُمْ. Athar is traces. So your sadaqah jariyah, that traces that people pick up and use, like this, using the, you know, giving the hasanat to Shaykh Safi Rahman Rahimahullah, like that, right? So these, whatever you left behind, a righteous child that worships Allah, that prays, that gives sadaqah, that makes dua for you, that gives sadaqah on your behalf, right? A righteous child, right? That you deposited and put so he can learn some aspects of the deen. And now, you know, you passed away. You know, everything that he learned during that time that maybe he didn't use when you were alive, but maybe afterwards he will use it. You will, that those hasanat, they will never go to waste. You'll always get the hasanat. You will always get those good deeds. So here, the what is mentioned in meaning is based on a hadith. And this Shawaliullah Dahlawi, Rahimahullah, Shawaliullah Dahlawi wrote a book, The 40 Hadith of Shawaliullah Dahlawi. Like Imam al-Nawawi wrote 40 Hadith of Imam al-Nawawi, like Imam al-Suyuti wrote 40 Hadith of Imam al-Suyuti, like Mula Ali Qari wrote 40 Hadith of Mula Ali Qari, etc., etc., etc. So many scholars wrote 40 Hadith. So in the 40 Hadith, because I'm currently reading it, so it's fresh in my mind, Shawaliullah Dahlawi selected hadith that are very spiritual, but at the same time very brief. Right? For example, al Muslim mira'ul Muslim. The Muslim is the mirror of a Muslim. What does it mean? That I am a reflection of you, and you're a reflection of me. Right? That means that if I am going to correct you, then I have to do it with the proper, following the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and doing it in private, because if I humiliate you, I'm actually humiliating myself too. Look at that. So this is the lessons of that. So now, from this statement about the ajr, that alimat nafsu ma qaddamat wa akharat, the hadith is man dalla ala khair. Whoever guides, right, or leads, or guides, or directs towards any good, falahu ajaruhu, right? So falahu aj, so he will get the reward, right? The same as fa'ilihi, as the one that does it, right? And in a longer hadith it says, and nothing will be deficient from the one that does it. If the person does it, he will get his reward in full, and that person, because he led him to that good, he will also get the reward the same. Right? So subhanAllah. So this is what it indicates. Alimat nafsu ma qaddamat wa akharat. So whatever you leave behind, if you leave good, let's say you talk bad. Right? And this is what's very, very, very delicate. Very delicate in matters of the deen, in matters of worship. Right? Like somebody asked me, like, let's say instead of doing the wudu 3 times, let's say I want to do it more. So I said, look, there's two indications. One is that you minimize and don't waste so much water, and you use the least amount as you can, but do it perfect in your wudu. And the other one is that the Prophet ﷺ said that in the day of judgment, my followers will come with lights in the traces of wudu. Athar al-wudu. The word athar again. So wherever he did wudu, there will be light from his arms, from his face, from all the positions that you make wudu, right? So the Prophet ﷺ said, so let him increase his light. Let whoever wants, right, increase his light. So it tells you, if you want to increase your light, khair, it's okay. If you want to also in worship, like for example, the madmada. In the Shafi'iyya, they do the madmada wal istinshaq one time. So it's al madmada wal istinshaq. So it's water, mouth and nose. One. Mouth and nose, two. Mouth and nose, three. Right? So it's three times. Right? You can also do, because there's narrations, right? And as other madhab do, you do madmada three times. One, two, three. Nose, three times. But if you add it six times, right? So if you do three times because you want to minimize as worship, it's okay. If you have like less amount of water, you do it like that. Right? So this is comprehension, right? Comprehension, but we go again, يُرِيدُ اللَّهَ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. Allah wants to make it easy for you, not difficult. Right? So that's the athar, the good deeds, right? But if let's say you tell somebody, you teach your son, right? Now, you know what? Just in case, just do it four. And then he learns it four. And throughout his life, he continues doing it four, instead of three, right? And then he goes and teaches to his kids and his kids. So anything that goes against the sunnah is bid'ah, right? So the sunnah is three times, the obligatory is one, right? The sunnah is three times, obligatory is one. And when a sunnah is abandoned, then a bid'ah takes its place. That's why we have to be very careful. So in matters of worship, be extreme. Okay, next. So now the next ayah 7, 8, and 9. Yes, sister. Can you read 7, 8, and 9? You can read it in English, inshallah. I'll read it in Arabic. الَّذِي خَلَقَكَ فَسَوَّاكَ فَعَدَلَكَ. Symmetry.
Gives him beauty. That is what Allah calls destitia. In verse 4 of 18, surely he created man of the best
teacher. Yes, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears, right? So we mentioned that before. Jay, so continue. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. في أي سورة ما شاء ركبك. So know that when there's tanween and there's a meme, في أي سورة ما شاء ركبك. No, Mama still, right? So she has 7, 8, and 9. Okay. Number 9. Kalla bal tukadhibuna biddin.
But you deny again the day of recompense. You are careless concerning your Lord. The real reason for that is that you do not believe in the day of resurrection. If you did and knew for your action, you will never disbelieve in Allah, nor ascribe partners with Him.
Okay, mashallah, good. So now in this year, كَلَّا بَلْ تُكَذِّبُونَ بِالدِّينِ, right? If I ask you, what is the meaning of the word deen? Deen ul Islam, religion of Islam. But here it means what? مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ, the day of judgment, day of recompense. Same word, deen. Huh? See what I'm saying? That the one word branches out, right? And the day of recompense is part of Islam. So it's part of the deen of Islam, right? And it's a fundamental part of the creed of Islam, right? So here is rejecting that, is rejecting Islam. Allah says, أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ, have you not seen the one who rejects the day of judgment? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the day of recompense, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you a different characteristics of that person. And he prays to be seen. He doesn't focus. He's forgetful. He doesn't give to the poor, to the orphans, right? Etc. Okay, so the next one is so 10, 11, and 12, inshallah. Yes, 10, 11, and 12. You want me to read the Arabic? Okay, good. Bismillah. Wa inna alaykum la hafidin. كراما كاتبين good. So كاتبين are scribes. Here كاتبين, so it means honorable scribes. So honorable scribes, what are they writing? Are they writing the Quran? Are they writing? They're writing your deeds. That's the explanation. Good. يَعْلَمُونَ مَا تَفَعَلُونَ,
they know all that you do.
So that's scary.
You deny the day of accounting, but we do not know that we have appointed angels who record whatever you say or do. It is a warning to mankind, like seated on the right hand and on the left. He utters no word, but there is
Surat Qaf.
It is said that there is one angel who records good deeds of men, while another records his bad deeds. According to some narrations, two angels remain with him during the day and two during the night. The following verses mention the righteous and the wicked.
Okay, so here what it mentions about, according to some narrations, two angels remain with him during the day and two during the night. What does this mean? Right? What does this mean? Right? That in the morning, right, a group of angels go up to the heavens and Allah will ask them, how did you leave my servants? How did you leave my servants, right? And then the ones in Asr, right? Right, the ones that came in Fajr and replaced the two that left in Fajr, right? Those two that came in Fajr will leave in Asr, and the other two will come and replace it. So we will never be alone. We always will have kiram and katibin, honorable scribes. That's their duty, and they will report to Allah how did they leave us, like in Hadith Qudsi, right? Hadith Qudsi, Allah will ask the angel, how do you leave my servant? What were they doing? They were remembering you. Right? They were remembering you. Okay. And what did they seek? Right? What did they seek? They saw paradise. Did they see it? No, they didn't see it. How would it have been if they would have seen it? They would work harder for it. Right? And what did they seek refuge in? They saw refuge in the hellfire. How would it have been if they would If they would have seen, did they see it? No, they didn't see it. How would it have been if they had seen it? They will flee from it and flee from actions that lead to it. Right? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, then I have forgiven them, right? And then the angel said, you know, amongst them was a person that wasn't in the gathering, wasn't remembering you, but he happened to be there, right? Then I also forgive him too. Just for being in that company. Even if he was not even present, his heart wasn't even present. He was just there. Body was there, soul, mind then was somewhere else. Thinking about business, all these things, right? Still look at the rahmah of Allah. If we look at a person like that, we will say, why do you come? Why do you waste your time? Don't come. Don't waste my time. Don't waste others' time. But look at Allah. It's Hadith Qudsi. Right? So his mercy supersedes everything. Jay, so kiraman katibin ya'lamuna ma taf'alun. Jay, so 13, 14, and 15. Next, Sister Tashima.
Verily, Al-Abrar, the pious believers of Islamic monotheism, will be in delight paradise. Wa innal fujjara lafi jahim.
So Al-Abrar, just Al-Abrar, look at the verse 177 in Surah Al-Baqarah. That's for homework, right? Right? When Allah says about Al-Bir, right? Al-Bir is not that you turn east or west. But Bir is what? And you believe in Allah, and it tells you, it describes it. So it's a good description of Al-Bir, right? And Al-Bir, righteousness is intertwined with taqwa. And in that ayah, at the end, it tells you, that it mentions taqwa as well. So I just wanted to, because it gives a little bit more insight.
What's the verse?
177 of Surah Al-Baqarah. Yeah. Jay, so the next ayah, 14.
Wa innal fujjara lafi jahim. And verily, al-fujjar, the wicked disbelievers, polytheists, sinners, and even jurors will be in the blazing fire hell.
Okay, so if you look at, I want you to just look at this. So this type of translation, right, this from the Quran itself, the English part, that comes from the Noble Quran, right? The Noble Quran, I think, Sister Shanaz, the red Quran that you have, that's the Noble Quran, right? Is it Noble Quran?
Yeah.
So the Noble Quran has a lot of parentheses, right? So if you want to look into the meaning of words, it's very useful. And also it has the hadith in the bottom. Right? Okay, so now I'm gonna just give you a little insight of translations. So you have Yusuf Ali, Abdullah Yusuf Ali, right? And then you have Muhammad Piktor, and then you have now what's one of the recommended, highly recommended, is one Sahih International. That one, Sahih International, that one is actually taken from. I mean, that one, I would say, like, for example, if you're going to give it to a new Muslim, Sahih International is better. Why? Because it's taken from a Noble Quran, but it minimized the brackets. Why? So that it can be an easy flow. Right? Because when you're reading, for example, if you're reading, you want to get that spiritual benefit, but there's always interruptions. Right? Brackets, right? And a lot of words. So it throws you off. But it has a lot of benefit because it is condensed. So there's a lot of benefit to it. For someone that really wants to learn like this, like now that we're doing tafsir, al-fujjar, the wicked, the disbelievers, the polytheists, the sinners, and the evildoers. All of that branches out in Arabic of the word fujjar. Okay? So this is very reliable. So you can expand your definition. Ayat. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ آيَةٍ signs, evidence, proofs, revelation. Right? That's the way it's defined. Taqwa, to love Allah and obey Him, to fear Allah and avoid disobeying Him. That's the way it's defined in the Noble Quran. So it's beneficial. You get used to it, right? But it would be good to also have, for example, a Quran like that you can easily, like this one, it was recently done, and a lot of imams and scholars, they recommend it. It's very simple, English, and very, it's recommended as well. So it's good to know, alhamdulillah, online you have access to all these different translations, so you don't have to keep buying Qur'ans, alhamdulillah. So just wanted to mention that this parentheses and definition come from the Noble Qur'an, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward the scholars that took the time to put all those details and to put the ahadith in the bottom to make it easier for us to have this condensed Qur'an, right? Now, for example, for a new Muslim or a non-Muslim, is a little bit overwhelming, right? That it's a little bit overwhelming because they need the quick medicine, right? So simplifying things is always good, based on levels. Jade. So the next one. So continue the explanation of that ayah. Allah says. What is it? Yeah, okay, it's okay. I don't remember it right now. Good. So is that you had 13, 14, and 15, right?
Okay, 15.
Yes, law naha.
Yes, law naha, yawm ad-din. Therein they will enter and taste his burning flame on the day of recompense. They will enter hell on the same day, the day of judgment, which they used to deny.
Good. Okay, good. 16, 17, and 18. Sister Shamas.
ثم ما أدرك ما يوم الدين again what will make you know what the day of recompense is. The purpose of repetition is to drive home the importance of the day.
You can add, like you can write next to it. If you have a pencil, right? I would prefer when you have a textbook or book, is if you're gonna write in it, you write in it with a pencil, right? It will last, but as well, you don't damage the book. If later on, as you grow, as you learn, and maybe that which you wrote might be wrong, right? That's for human beings. So here, what you the day, next to the importance of the day, you put recompense again, or the day of judgment, right? Just to know that what's that day. Right, and also I wanted to highlight one thing. When it says Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, yaslawnaha yawma yawma ad-din, yaslawnaha yawma yawma is maf'ul, and that's why it's fatha. Wama hum anha bighaibin, wama adraka ma yawm ad-din. Right now that's it's marfu' يوم الدين ثم ما أدراك ما يوم الدين. So يوم يوم الدين, right? And then the last ayah 19. So you did 19, so 18, right, sister?
Yeah.
Okay. So ayah 19, brother Salim. Ayah.
يوم لا تملك نفس لنفس.
Join us.
Samina, kul amru yawma idhin lillah.
Jai.
It is the day when no soul will have power to do their deeds or souls, and God's alone will be done. This is a different translation.
It's okay, not okay. Okay, the day?
In the day when no soul will have power to do the least for a soul, and God's alone will be there done.
The reason being, right, the reason that translation like that is because the word nafs, right, which is soul, right, nafs. So spirit, soul, so here. But here means person, because on that day, the soul will not only be raised, right? It's both soul and body. And the body without the soul is not complete. Right? كُلُّ نَفْسٍ دَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul will taste death. So the body also tastes, right? It's all together. And the tasting of death is the separation of one and the other. So here, the day, يَوْمَ لَا تَمْلِكُ نَفْسٌ لِنَفْسٍ شَيْئًا. The day that no human being will have power to do anything, right? وَالْأَمْرُ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلَّهِ. All of the matters and affairs rest with Allah, right? All of the matters. So that no longer we are the authority. In our home, نحن رب البيت, الأب رب البيت, right? The Lord of the Lord of the master of the house, right? The Lord of the house. Rabbul Bayt, Abdul Muttalib, when Abraha came and took his camels, and finally Abraha met him and said and saw him and with this great stature, right? The position, said, look, you with a man of honor. And then he asked him, and he knew that he was going to destroy the Kaaba. That's what his intent, the intent of Abraha and his army. But what happened? What happened was that Abraha asked him, so what do you want from me? What do you ask from me? He said, I want my camels. Right? If you look at the tafsir of Ibn Kathir, Surah Al-Fil, you see the story, right? He said, I want my camels. Right? So Abraha said, you know, I lost respect for you. I come to destroy your Kaaba, and you asked me for your camels. You didn't say spare the Kaaba. And Abdul Muttalib, the grandfather of the Prophet, said, well, Ana Rabbul Jamal. I am the Lord of the camels. But the Lord of the house will take care of it. The Lord of the house will take care of his house. Look at that. That's even before the message of Islam. Before ayats of the Quran. They still had traces of Iman, of the deen of Ibrahim alayhi salam. They still had it. Right? But it was mixed and corrupted with the idol worship and this and this and that. So we also have some sense of authority, right? So we have authority in our home, sometimes in our job, etc., etc. But on that day, يَوْمَ لَا تَمْلِكُ نَفْسٌ لِنَفْسٍ شَيْئًا وَالْأَمْرُ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلَّهِ. The authority rests with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I would conclude, inshallah, so we can make the adhan with just a reminder of when we were reading Surah At-Takwir, right, in the beginning, there was a hadith, right? And the hadith says that the Prophet ﷺ said, whosoever likes to see the events of the day of resurrection with his own eyes, if he wants to see the imagery, if he wants to get the image of what would happen, then let the person recite carefully, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ إِذَا السَّمَاءُ فَطَرَتْ وَإِذَا السَّمَاءُ شَقَّتْ. Let him recite these three surahs, carefully trying to understand them. So we're tying it together. We're bringing it, but when we do the Samatum Shakkat, we will bring the hadith again as a reminder, because the reminder benefits the believers. Right? So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with understanding the Quran. Bi'idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala, next week we will do the summary of Tafsir Maudu'i, breaking down from ayah 1 to so and so is about this subject, from ayah this to that, it was about that subject, and then we will also cover lessons derived from the surah in addition to the vocabulary words. Barakallahu fikum. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت نستغفرك واتوب اليك. So can I please have someone to make the assalamu alaikum to anyone that watched the presentation. Barakallahu fikum.